morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Glad that you are here on this beautiful day, and looks like maybe we avoided some rain this morning, so always good for drive-in worship to avoid that, but glad that you're here. We will continue with our confession and forgiveness as you see it on the screen before you, and I invite you to stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
From the outside, and cleanse us from all evils that arise from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Be seated. We will read Psalm 15 responsively.
Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Who may abide upon your holy hill? They do not slander with the tongue. They do no evil to their friends. They do not cast discredit upon their neighbor.
In their sight, the wicked are rejected, but they honor those who fear the Lord. They have sworn upon their belt.
And do not take back their word. They do not give their money in hope of gain, nor do they take bribes against the innocent. Those who do these things shall never be overthrown. The second reading is from James. Every generous act of giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget what they were like. For those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God. the 7th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Pharisees, along with some religious scholars who had come from Jerusalem, gathered around him. They noticed that some of his disciples weren't being careful with ritual washings before meals. The Pharisees, Jews in general, in fact, would never eat a meal without going through the motions of a ritual hand washing, with an especially vigorous scrubbing if they had just come from the market, to say nothing of the scourings they give jugs and pots and pans. The Pharisees and religion scholars asked, "Why do your disciples brush off the rules, showing up at meals without washing their hands?" Jesus answered, "Isaiah was right about frauds like you. Hit the bullseye, in fact. These people make a big show of saying the right thing, but their heart isn't in it. They act like they're worshiping me, but they don't mean it." Jesus called the crowd together again and said, "Listen now, all of you, take this to heart. It's not what you swallow that pollutes your life. It's what you vomit. That's the real pollution." When he was back home after being with the crowd, the disciples said, "We don't get it. Put it in plain language." Jesus said, "Are you being willfully stupid? Don't you see that what you swallow can't contaminate you? It doesn't enter your heart, but your stomach works its way through the intestines and is finally flushed." That took care of dietary quibbling. Jesus was saying that all foods are fit to eat. And he went on, "It's what comes out of a person that pollutes. Obscenities, lusts, thefts, murders, adulteries, greed, depravity, deceptive dealings, carousing, mean looks, slander, arrogance, foolishness. All these are vomit from the heart. There is the source of your pollution." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. So that reading is from a translation called The Message. And it puts things in a kind of a different light than we might normally get in the NRSV, which is what we normally use. But that reading was the gospel, and that word gospel means good news. Now, what you heard me read may not have sounded a whole lot like good news. Jesus is talking about health and pollution and sanitation and the rules surrounding those things. And it can be hard to see the good news in those things. Nonetheless, I think it's there if we have eyes to see it. So while this gospel reading might feel a little bit bizarre to us, I think it's actually quite insightful for our current predicament. Now, we might hear these words of Jesus about the disciples not washing their hands and being reprimanded by the Pharisees for it. We might say, "Well, actually, Jesus, there's quite a lot that can come from outside you that contaminates you. You know, germs, viruses, diseases, maybe this little thing called COVID-19. But Jesus is right. What defiles us, what really defiles us as a people, is what comes from within us. Things like the selfishness to care more about avoiding any inconvenience than about the well-being of those around us. And while the virus might come from outside us when we get infected, the real danger, I think, has come from within us. The reason that this current pandemic has snowballed into what it has, and the reason that it has continued and even resurged in recent months, is due to these inner issues: selfishness, greed, deceit. The existence and prevalence of these evil mindsets is what causes not just this problem, but all our problems. Our current climate crisis, a result of unmitigated greed and deceit on the part of a handful of oil tycoons. Our current pandemic, partially a result of the climate crisis, and the prolonging of the pandemic due to widespread deceit to lead people astray. Now, once again, you may be saying, "Pastor Seth, I thought you were talking about the gospel today. This still doesn't sound like good news. I don't know where the good news is in this." So let's think about this word for a second. The Lutheran understanding of a sermon is that it is primarily proclamation of the gospel. And that gospel comes to us through a Greek word meaning literally good news. So the gospel is good news. And it is good news for everyone. Although sometimes it's not initially perceived as good news by everyone. So we talk about our initial perceptions. You think about when the gospel's presented, some people hear it as good news and some people might not. I think this is why when John the Baptist is doubting whether Jesus is actually the Messiah, he's in prison, and he sends his disciples to Jesus and asks, are you the Messiah or should we wait for another one? Jesus tells those disciples, he doesn't say, well, yes, I am. Take heart to be encouraged. He says, the poor have good news preached to them. Now, why specifically the poor? Well, the poor are able to understand the good news of the gospel immediately because it's so obviously good news for them. In their current state, they can understand and grasp that this is good news right off the bat. But other groups, such as the converse of the poor, the ultra-wealthy, may not initially understand the gospel as good news. You might think of Jesus' interaction with the rich young ruler who ends up walking away from Jesus, incredibly sad. Jesus instructed him to give up all he had, to sell it and give it to the poor, and to follow Christ. And that rich man was unwilling to do it. He could not hear the gospel. He could not understand that the gospel was good news for him. The same might be said, perhaps, of our modern rich young rulers and the calls for them to sell their worldly possessions and give them to the poor. They, too, fail to grasp the good news in it for them. The rich young ruler could not hear the gospel as good news, not just to the poor, but also to him as well. Now, I think if he had stuck with it, he would have seen that in the long run, he would have gained much more by following Christ than he would have given up by losing his riches. And this is the crux of the issue, folks. The gospel is good news for everyone. I said that before, and I mean it. Everyone wins in this scenario. I truly believe that. But for some groups, it's harder to understand that right away. We may, in addition to the rich young ruler, we may think of the scenario of the Emancipation Proclamation. In that situation, the slaves are the poor. And they immediately understand the development as good news, liberation from slavery. To the slave owners, however, they can only see all the riches they have to lose by this development. They're so blinded by that material wealth and their desire to cling to it that they secede from the U.S. and include the word slavery dozens of times in their articles of secession as the reason for doing so. They fight a war and lose lots of lives over their desire to cling to that wealth and power. But just like the rich young ruler, there was always the possibility that they could have seen the end of slavery as good news for them too, and not just for the slaves. You see, the evil of slavery visited violence on the slaves, to be sure, but also visited violence on the souls of the slave owners. It warped them. It damaged their spirits. So they too were the benefactors of the Emancipation Proclamation, if only they had the eyes to see it. They were also liberated from the grips of slavery, if they were willing to understand it. Now, we good and enlightened folks, 150 years later, can nod our heads in solemn agreement. So let's perhaps venture into a more current example. This week, a vaccine has become available to every American adult with full FDA approval, just like all the other vaccines that we're required to take in order to go to school and participate in society. And it's given free of charge. But just like the rich young ruler, and just like the slave owners, some people can only see what they think they have to lose. They'll argue that it's a loss of freedom if they get the vaccine or if they're required to. Now, we could interact with that idea about it being a loss of freedom. We could perhaps, first of all, look at Paul, the apostle, who says that he is bound by no law, but has made himself a slave to all. 1 Corinthians 9, Paul says, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? This is my defense for those who would examine me. Do we not have the right to do as we wish concerning our bodies, what goes into them? But I have made no use of any of these rights, for I am writing this so that they may be, so they may not be applied in my case. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation has been laid on me. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all. In other words, St. Paul is saying that as followers of Christ, we are bound, obliged to do what is best for those around us. In our case, in the case of the pandemic, I believe that means being vaccinated so that you greatly decrease the chance not only of yourself contracting the disease, but also decrease the chance of passing it on to others, even if you don't feel sick. So you protect others and do what's in their best interest, not just your own. Now, we could go further in talking about freedom, and we could say that even if this was thought of as a loss of freedom, then that loss is the same loss as any loss of freedom we give up in order to participate in a functioning society. Everyone gives up freedoms to make society function. So for society to work, for instance, you cannot walk around and kill anybody you want. That is a freedom you give up in order to make society work. You also give up the freedom to lie at any moment you want. That is a loss of freedom so that our community can function. In other words, there's a whole host of things we give up so that we can live in harmony with each other. That's the price of community. And folks, it's a small price. But even more than those interactions with the notion that being asked or hypothetically required to get a vaccine is a loss of freedom, I think that whole idea misses the point. Just like the rich young ruler failed to see all he had to gain, and the slave owners failed to see all they had to gain, so too does a person who refuses the vaccine fail to see that rather than it being a loss of freedom, it is in fact liberation. To be freed from the grips of a worldwide pandemic is perhaps the greatest liberation that any of us could have imagined in our lifetime so far. Every single one of us wants to move past it. I know that. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, I want so badly for you to hear the gospel this morning. I myself need so badly to hear the gospel of Jesus this morning. The good news. I need good news. You need good news. And it is my absolute pleasure to declare to you that the good news of Jesus Christ, that your sins are forgiven, that you are loved into abundant life, and that you have a place in this community of faith. This family of faith looks out for each other. This family does what is best for each other. This family cares for one another. This family shares each other's burdens, weeping with those who weep and laughing with those who rejoice. Because our salvation is bound up together as a whole group. We are being saved together with all of creation. My salvation is inextricably linked to your salvation. My happiness is connected to your happiness. My peace is predicated on your peace. My abundant life is only made possible in your abundant life. This notion of rugged individualism is killing us. This week, Tim and I were reminded by another pastor that in Mary Shelley's classic horror novel, Frankenstein, that Frankenstein's monster, towards the end, goes insane. Because it's trying, this new creation, it's trying to understand life, to grasp what existence is, completely separated from community, completely in isolation. And you can't do it. On your own, life is nonsensical, meaningless. Only in the context of community can we understand who we are, what we're doing, why we're here, and how to have an abundant life. So this perspective that clings to personal freedoms at the expense of everything else ends up getting us all killed. When you're on a ship together, an individual does not have the right to punch holes in the bottom of the boat. Restraining him might cause cries of losing our freedoms. But if you don't do it, the whole ship sinks and everyone drowns. We are responsible for each other, born out of the love of Christ, to protect the vulnerable and all others. We ought to ask ourselves, if we cannot do those things, we ought to ask ourselves whether we're following Christ or whether we're following some online celebrity feeding us the things we want to hear. We ought to hear the words from our psalm this morning that you heard Ken read and that we read responsibly this morning. Do no evil. This is the first commandment in the Physician's Creed: do no harm. We who are followers of the great physician, Jesus Christ, would do well to adopt a similar policy. Indeed, Martin Luther has already set the precedent for us. He said, "I shall ask God mercifully to protect us. Then I will fumigate, purify the air, administer medicine, and take medicine. I shall avoid places and persons where my presence is not needed in order to not become contaminated, and thus perchance inflict and pollute others, and so cause their death as a result of my negligence." Martin Luther said that in the midst of the bubonic plague that ravaged Europe in the 1500s. Now, the bubonic plague, the Black Death, had waves of its own, you know, much like our current plague, much more spread out. The first wave was in the 1300s, and Luther, of course, wrote this later in the 1500s during its second wave. And it almost feels a bit on the nose as if he was speaking to our current circumstance. But what we're learning now about the real source of our pollution, as Jesus says, or where pollution comes from, whether from without us or from within us, what we're learning now isn't just contextual to this moment. It'll be useful in the future too. Plagues happened in Luther's time, they're happening now, and they will happen again, perhaps sooner than any of us would like to acknowledge. I read a study from Duke University this week. It said that the probability of a pandemic of similar proportions to COVID-19 is about 2% in any year, which was alarming and was a higher number than previously thought. And it means that children born in the last 10 years, such as my two kids, are more likely than not to experience another such global pandemic in their lifetimes. And that probability is only growing due to changes in our environment and our climate. As the body of Christ, we have a unique opportunity. The church can inspire people to not only care for each other right now, but to help the whole community pick up the pieces and rebuild after the damage is done, so that God's promised redemption and recuperation can begin. And in this case, my friends, that recuperation begins with a vaccine and mask wearing. My understanding, of course, is that most of you, if not possibly all of you, have already been vaccinated. Very proud of that. I'm very happy for you and for all of us as a faith family. I rejoice with you in that reality. So I want to thank you for what you've done in proclaiming the gospel of healing. Because of you, and because of this whole church's work together in the community, the gospel has worked our way into the community in a new way, unlike it ever has before. Your work matters. Our work together matters. It is, taken together, a proclamation of the good news of liberation. And because of this good news, we indeed have much reason to rejoice. Amen.
Thank you.
Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. We pray for the church, that it is a safe haven for all who seek your presence. Fill it with pastors, deacons, and leaders who echo your expansive and generous welcome. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the whole of creation, that plants and animals have the habitat and resources to thrive and flourish. Inspire us to protect threatened habitats and ensure a sustainable future for generations to come. We pray for those affected by Hurricane Ida. Protect and comfort them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for individuals in positions of authority, such as our president, our governor, Dane County public health officials, and our own mayor. Raise up wise and discerning leaders in federal, state, and local governments, and guide them to seek the benefit of every person, including all in Afghanistan, that they might find peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are in need. We pray especially for Dale, Chris, John, Susan, Wesley, Mary Beth, Bonnie, and Nancy, and Gary. Also support and encourage those who are unemployed, underemployed, or experiencing poverty. Bring food, shelter, clothes, and stability for daily life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this congregation, especially those beginning a new school year. Bless, encourage, and protect students, parents, and teachers. Empower teachers and school administrators. Guide students in their learning and development. Accompany parents, foster parents, and caregivers who provide encouragement and love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the faithful departed who showed us how to honor God with our heart, especially Joyce Spildy and Eldon Grunewald. Comfort their families as they mourn their deaths this last week. Inspire us by their example and renew our faith, trusting that we will be united with them in glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share that peace with one another. God's peace, Ken. So if you want to take out your communion cups and take off the first cellophane lid and get the wafer out and then the next lid and prepare yourself for communion this morning, we will continue with that. Dear friends in Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come. This is the body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Amen. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Well, again, thank you for coming to worship today. Glad that you could be here with us. Just a couple of things. It's a pretty quiet week as we head into the end of August and the beginning of September. There are some sign-ups available for Sunday school and things like that. Just a reminder that in a couple of weeks, we'll be gathering on the 12th as a way of sending me off on sabbatical. There will be a part of the service, kind of a sending service. And then after the 10:30 service, there's going to be a kind of a picnic outside that you can come and kick me out the doors. As I head out, I leave for California at 2 in the afternoon on the 12th, so it'll be, I get in my car and start driving, so it should be a crazy week or so out there. But anything else you can see in our newsletter, again, continue to pray for Seth. As I leave, that he has some strength and support, and if he needs help, please help him out, that's for sure. But I invite you to receive God's blessing for the day. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Peace, you are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.